Thank you. The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 10747 in the name of Gordon MacDonald on contribution of the Scottish convenience store sector. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Gordon MacDonald to open the debate. Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'll take this opportunity to thank those members who supported my motion in order that this debate could take place this evening. I also welcome to the gallery members of the Scottish Grocers Federation, who back in 2017 were instrumental and supportive of my steps to establish the cross-party group on independent convenience stores. This most recent Scottish Shop Local report for 2023, produced by the Scottish Grocers Federation and the Association of Convenience Stores, was distributed to all members in the last couple of weeks. This annual report highlights not only the contribution the sector makes to the Scottish economy, but more important, the essential contribution convenience stores make to the local communities they serve. Across Scotland, there are 5,171 convenience stores, many of which are open 24/7 and are an important source of local employment, providing over 49,000 local jobs for local people, from a first job for a young person, or indeed a route back into employment through offering flexible hours for those who have to balance ongoing family or caring commitments. Our economy also benefits as these local retailers not only provide jobs within their own business, but through the use of local tradesmen, produce suppliers, shop fitters and garages, as well as local legal and accountancy firms. They support employment across the town or city they are located. In the last year, convenience stores invested £62 million in their business, purchasing refrigeration equipment, shelving, signage, lighting and new technology, again supporting employment in the wider economy. A survey by Scotland's Town Partnership found that 91% of Scots recognised that choosing local businesses supported local jobs and employment opportunities. In addition, choosing local keeps money circulating in the local community longer, reduces unnecessary journeys and helps tackle the climate crisis. So why shop local? Well, in my constituency of Edinburgh Pentlands and across the country, 83% of convenience stores offer mobile top-ups, 76% offer bill payment services, 47% of free ATMs, and 27% of post offices. And others also have online shopping with home delivery included. The data also highlights that 36% of convenience stores are in rural areas, and another 27% are in outlying parts of our cities and towns, providing a focal point for communities as they are often the only retailer in the area. The stores carry a wide range of products, and the Shop Local report highlights that an average independent convenience store, 4,735 individual products are stocked during the course of a year, including staple items such as bread, milk, toiletries and pet food. These stores become a meeting place for locals and therefore are more than just places to shop, but are vital community hubs with services such as post office, parcel collection, bill paying, while also providing cash back and free-to-use ATMs, which customers may use to make purchases in other nearby businesses, thereby supporting the growth of the local economy. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government policy is to encourage local living and the development of 20-minute neighbourhoods where people can meet most of their daily needs within a reasonable distance of their home. Convenience stores are by their very nature at the heart of this policy, with 51% of store customers living within a quarter of a mile of their nearest retailer, and 59% of those customers travel to their local store by foot or by bike. Because these stores are at the heart of their communities, the average customer visits their convenience store nearly three times per week, and 36% know the people running and working in their local shop very well or quite well, according to the survey. As a result of the close connection with local residents, 81% of retailers are engaged in some form of community activity in the last year, This takes many forms and can include collecting for charities, providing funding for local events, or sponsorship for local sports teams. Presiding Officer, this close relationship between store owners and customers is highlighted in one example from my constituency. Linda and Dennis Williams, who have run the Oxgang's Premier Store for 40 years, along with daughter Sophie, realised that during the pandemic, many of their customers were struggling to put food on the table. They decided to set up a coronavirus hardship fund, using their own money to help the most vulnerable members of the local community, and asked the community to match fund with the aim of raising a total of £500. Yes, sure.
Audrey Nicol.
Fingway, and as the daughter of a grocer, I'm utterly loyal to local convenience stores, and I'm very much enjoying this debate. Would the member also agree that local stores also have almost a health and well-being benefit, just if you started to describe, in that if, for example, Mrs Smith, who's usually in three times a week, isn't appearing, then staff in a store would recognise that. So there's a sort of extended benefit there.
Gordon MacDonald.
Yeah, absolutely. I do agree with that. And also the fact that some of them do deliveries to homes where people are housebound or have got caring responsibilities, then they can keep an eye on the most vulnerable in society. So thanks very much for that intervention. The only issue is I've forgotten my arm now. To their surprise, they hit their initial target in the space of 24 hours from the local community. However, as more people became aware of this much-needed initiative to help those struggling during the pandemic, the money continued to be received and eventually raised over £10,000. The hardship fund was handed out in small amounts with no questions asked to ensure that the money was used to help as many people as possible, whether it was to pay for food or household bills. Their efforts made a huge difference to many in the community, and they quite rightly received wide recognition, winning a number of awards, including last month the Raj Agarwal Trophy by the Association of Convenience Stores, awarded to retailers who have demonstrated an exceptional commitment to community retailing over the last year, supporting their colleagues, customers and fellow retailers, representing the very best of community retailing. Presiding Officer, the convenience store sector has faced many hardships in recent years, from the financial crash of 2008, the pandemic, Brexit food shortages, and now inflationary pressure on overheads. Scottish Government offered support earlier this year by funding the Go Local project, offering a match funding grant worth up to £5,500 per store to convenience shop owners to provide dedicated long-term display space for locally sourced, fresh and healthy Scottish products. Stores that took part in the initial pilot saw a 40% increase in sales of local products and delivered additional local economic benefits in excess of £159,000 per store. The initiative enabled stores to support Scottish producers and give those businesses a vital route to market to help with the recovery and regrowth from COVID-19. So at a time when households and businesses are bearing the brunt of Westminster's cost of living crisis, it is right that we celebrate the hard work and resilience of Scotland's convenience sector.
Thank you, Mr MacDonald. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Murdo Fraser. Mr Coffey.
Presiding Officer, thanks very much. And thank you once again to my colleague, Gordon MacDonald, for highlighting the crucial role that Scotland's convenience stores play within all of our communities, the length and breadth of the country. He has been a dedicated supporter of the sector for many years, and it's right to recognise his commitment tonight. The Scottish Local Shop Report for 2023 is absolutely packed, full of helpful facts and figures that give us a flavour of the incredible diversity of the sector and its importance to the local communities they serve. Gordon has shared a range of them to give us a sense of this, and there are a few others that stood out for me. One was the convenience store sector sales turnover in the UK is about £49 billion per year and predicted to hit £50 billion by 2026. That's an impressive figure, and it certainly surprised me about the value and extent of the whole business to the wider Scottish economy. The secret is in the title, of course. It's convenience. And as we know, their origins are rooted in an era where few people had cars and the supermarket model, drawing thousands of shoppers at a time to out-of-town locations, was only just emerging. Their continuing success is that they're located where people need them, in the heart of the communities they serve, and the shop report also tells us that roughly two out of every three customers who use their local convenience stores still walk there to use them every day. It's a remarkable success story that we often take for granted, and it's probably no surprise, given the size and success of the sector, that the supermarkets are doing their best to mirror the convenience store model and grab a slice of that business through their multiple small shops that seem to be ever expanding. Gordon MacDonald has highlighted the increasing diversity of products and services that our local shops now offer in the modern era, and these include things like Wi-Fi services, click and collect, paying bills, cashback services, postal facilities, home deliveries, picking up prescriptions and cutting keys. Some of those services, presiding officer, provided a vital lifeline for many families during the COVID emergency and have thankfully remained in place. I don't recall any of those services being available when I was a youngster being sent to the shop by my mother for odds and ends every day. So it's a testament to how they have adapted to fast-changing needs and demands within their communities. Presiding officer, all of us will know a convenience store locally to us, to whom we turn for those essentials. And one of my local stores is W&D Minto, who have operated in Dean Street in Kilmarnock since 1953, that's 70 years. Every day I pass by, Dougie Minto can be seen in the shop, bringing in all those goods we've been talking about. But it's much more than that. His shop, himself and his staff, are a community focal point too. He knows everyone in the area. He knows who needs help, and he is much more of a community champion than anyone I've ever known. So long may Dougie and his shop continue. The biggest change, though, says Dougie, in his time, is the plummeting sales of newspapers. Technology has played a huge part in that. But so too, I suspect, is the editorial and style and content of many of today's newspapers that seem to be ever more extreme and out of touch with the ordinary people of Scotland. Presiding officer, our convenience shops are much more than their title suggests. In many ways, they're the cornerstone of our communities, providing us with vital goods and services nearest to where we live. Hopefully, they will continue to offer these services far into the future. And lastly, thank you once again to my colleague, Gordon MacDonald, for bringing the success of our convenience stores to the attention of Parliament once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. I now call Murdo Fraser to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Mr. Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating Gordon MacDonald on securing this debate and associate myself with the wording of his motion, which I was very happy to sign, and also acknowledge the work that he does as convener of the cross-party group on independent convenience stores, which I'm happy to be a member and supporter of. Gordon MacDonald, in his opening remarks, referred to the recent Scottish Local Shop Report 2023. I think he quoted every single statistic from it, so I'm not going to repeat every single one of them, but just a few highlights, Presiding Officer. 49,000 jobs in the sector in Scotland, so a very significant footprint in terms of employment. £9.1 billion in taxes across the UK paid by the sector, so a significant economic and fiscal contribution. There are 5,171 convenience stores in Scotland. 70% of those are independently owned. So this is a sector made up of small, often family businesses. People, as we've already heard in the debate, working extremely hard, working very long hours and providing a vital service to their local communities. And the key point about convenience stores is that they are convenient. They are convenient for local people, often at the end of the street. And if we are concerned as a society about meeting net zero targets, we want to have convenient services available to people, so shops people can buy their groceries in within walking or cycling distance of their homes make a lot of sense.
And as Gordon MacDonald said, convenience stores provide a range of other services, such as mobile phone top-ups. They provide often post office services. They provide facilities for bill payments, for cashback, and a whole range of other activities are available within local neighbourhoods, and that's all very welcome. Now, Presiding Officer, I attended, and I was very pleased to attend as a guest, the Scottish Grocers Federation conference in Glasgow just last month. I think I might have been the only MSP who was there, and I very much enjoyed being part of that event, hearing about the success stories, celebrating a lot of the good news in the sector that we've already heard about. But there were also a number of challenges being raised by the sector that came out during that conference. There is a challenge around business rates. Now, many of these convenience stores will be beneath the threshold for paying business rates due to the small business bonus. Some of them will not. Some of them will be larger. Some of them will pay business rates. And it was raised with me a concern that retail businesses south of the border have a 75% rates relief in the current financial year, something that was not passed on by the Scottish Government to shops here in Scotland, and that has caused concern to those involved in businesses here. There was concern raised about the deposit return scheme, the shambolic deposit return scheme that I'm pleased to see has been shelved for the time being. But businesses in the sector are concerned that in due course that may come back and what that will mean for them and the costs involved in that. And also concerns about what might come down the track in terms of restrictions on the marketing of alcohol products, because alcohol forms an important part of the range of products on offer in many convenience stores. And if there were overly restrictive rules in terms of promotion of alcohol, as were being originally suggested, that could have a really negative impact on the sector. And that's another issue we need to be careful about. But the biggest concern in the sector is the rise in crime. The violence against shop workers, which has been growing. I know that Daniel Johnson, who's not with us tonight, took forward a member's bill on this previously to make it an enhanced offence to attack a shop worker. That's very welcome. But we still see too many attacks on shop workers. And we're seeing a dramatic increase in reports of shoplifting. Shoplifting, not, it seems to be due to increases in the cost of living and people shoplifting due to poverty, but shoplifting being arranged by organised crime, crime gangs going in and targeting particular products and targeting local shops. And there's a real concern that this is happening and there's a lack of deterrent. We do not have enough police around to try and deter these crimes. It's very difficult to catch people, and when they do, the penalties they receive are not sufficient enough to act as a deterrent. So we definitely need a more effective police presence, and we need a justice system that is properly punishing those who are caught. Presiding Officer, that's what those in the sector are calling for, and if we support the sector, we should be endorsing these calls and supporting them in their efforts to see more protection for those trying to earn a living in what can often be a difficult business. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. I now call Martin Whitfield, followed by Pam Gosen. Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I too compliment Gordon MacDonald on securing this most important debate. And it is a pleasure to follow Murdo Fraser, although I fear he may have been looking at my speech. I'm not sure how, the magic of the far bench. And also welcome the publication of the Scottish Local Shop Report in 2023. Because this does rightly shine a light on an incredibly important element of our communities. Once upon a time, we used to talk about the banks and the police stations. We used to talk about the services that were there. We used to talk about the cornerstones of our communities. And cornerstones are needed for communities to build resilience, to build knowledge and understanding, and to build network. And sadly, on so many levels, it is our convenience stores that are taking all four corners of that to make sure that our communities can survive. And in the plethora of data that has already been submitted, I would like to add sort of two aspects to that which I find fascinating. The first is in relation to the location of these convenience stores, where we have 36% in our rural communities, 37% in our urban communities, and 27% in our suburban communities. And I wonder what other economic unit can claim such coverage across Scotland. They do really sit at the heart of our communities. And again, when we look at the sort of communities they serve, 39% are isolated stores, frequently the only option for families. 27% sit on small parades, 10% on large parades, and 24% in the main streets in our cities. It shows that our convenience stores are not just the fabric of our communities, but they are an essential jigsaw. And I think that's reflected certainly in the knowledge that I have, both of the community in which I live in, but also across the south of Scotland, with stories that have been shared with me, both by convenience store operators and owners, but also by individuals. And I look back to COVID, where at the beginning, people didn't know where to turn, didn't know where to look. And so many of them went first to the shop that they go in nearly every day of their lives. And almost to the end, they were greeted, supported, and welcomed. I am aware of shopkeepers who put their hands in their own pockets for people, who assisted with food provision. I am aware of shops that went above and beyond, delivering to people who couldn't come out to their houses, something that imaginatively and entrepreneurially they have continued to do. And can I say, quite frankly, better than a lot of the large delivery services. And I trust my local convenience store to take in the package from those delivery services because I know it will be safe there. I know I can pick it up from someone I know. And I know it will be there when they say it's there. And so I don't think we can overstate the value of our convenience stores. But I think we should pay tribute to every single one of them, to the staff who go in, the staff who struggle sometimes because of some of the challenges which I will come to shortly. But the fact that they are there when our people, our communities need them is a great tribute to them. And we have a responsibility to allow that economic vehicle to continue. And that allows me to turn to some of the challenges which have already been raised in part by Murdo Fraser, the business rates, the energy bills, the fact that so many of the convenience stores run refrigerated units that they were suddenly thrown out in the sense of bill renewals that came up, the DRS that has been mentioned and may well come back. But I do want to spend a small part of the time talking about the violence and the theft, because that's what shoplifting is. The theft from these premises. And I find myself in slight disagreement with Murdo Fraser as to the reasons behind it. But I'm not sure there is value tonight in going into that. What I am aware of are shopkeepers who say to me, well, I let that person take that thing because I just knew they didn't have it and they needed it. And I am also aware of shopkeepers who have gone to the police with CCTV, with the name, with the address of the person who has taken stuff from the shop, and indeed have received little or no support in pursuing that. And these are small shops that cannot survive if they continue to be exposed to that sort of theft. But in concluding, I would like just also to mention, on a sad note, the violence that these shops and the people who work in them are facing. I think in part it's due to the pressures that exist within society. In part it's to do with a change in attitude. But I am aware of situations which have had the most horrible consequences for events that have started off in a shop. I am aware of people who have given up working in shops because of the violence they face. And to go back to the beginning of my contribution tonight, these are a crucial part of our community, and if we want to serve them the way they have served us for literally generations, we need to find a way to support those workers who are in there and support the owners. I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield, and I call Pam Gozo. Ms. Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm honoured to take part in today's debate on the contribution of the Scottish convenience sector, and I thank the member, Gordon MacDonald, for bringing it forward. While the member's motion talks in great detail about the sector's contribution to the economy, I would like to spend some time discussing the importance of Scottish convenience stores to our cultural and social fabric. I am a proud daughter of a former shopkeeper. Many of you seated here today undoubtedly have an image in your mind of your neighbourhood convenience stores. The welcoming faces, the familiarity, the dependability and the constancy. Convenience stores are like little lifesavers when we are in a hurry or just need a quick fix. But as the daughter of a shopkeeper, I know they are much more than that too. Convenience stores are the staple of communities. For many, it can be a light-hearted outing to pick up your goods, socialise or discuss neighbourhood drama. But for some, it is a sanctuary. As many of you are aware, I frequently bring up the comfort, safety and open ear my mum provided to victims of domestic abuse. Well, it was in my family's store in Argyll Street in Glasgow that she'd done that so. And I know that she will not be the only shopkeeper to have done this. The relationship forged over decades between customers and shopkeepers, particularly in the United Kingdom, is something to be celebrated. And I think that community bonds are the reason why Scottish convenience stores are so successful. As well as this, they are champions of the local community, with 65% collecting money for a local or national charity, 33% donating to a food bank, and 17% providing funding or in-kind support to community events. They also provide around 49,000 secure local jobs. It goes without question that the Scottish convenience stores are both socially and economically invaluable to the Scottish economy. But the question is whether this Parliament is doing all it can to ensure the industry reaches its full potential. So before I conclude, I would like to make a mention of Scottish retail crime, which my colleague Murdo Fraser has touched upon in his speech today. The amount of retail crime that the convenience industry is currently dealing with is just astounding. And our legal system is doing very little to help. Our courts and police personnel are in disarray. These days, organised crime groups and criminals think they are untouchable. Last week, we heard at the UK Retail Breakfast Roundtable event held in the Scottish Parliament that thugs are continually coming into stores, taking what they like and leaving. Some shopkeepers do not even bother reporting the crime anymore due to the fear of retribution and the fact that no police will attend or will arrive far too late. I do acknowledge that this is not directly the fault of the police service, but indeed a result of chronic underfunding of Police Scotland, a lack of resources and workforce shortages. Nonetheless, it is a huge problem and the Scottish Government must urgently address this situation. Small businesses cannot sustain continued losses, and we heard that today from the member, Martin Whitfield, that businesses are very little and every penny counts to them. That's in their profit margin. So, you know, we really do need to do much more to help these small, micro-small businesses. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, Scottish convenience stores are vital to this country's economy and society. They are evidence of relationships that have grown over decades between store owners and their patrons. While the future of the Scottish convenience sector seems promising, the SNP need to recognise that our retail sector is beginning to exhibit signs of a deficient justice system. A combination of fewer officers' numbers and a soft-touch justice system is allowing criminals to free rein. The SNP must act urgently to address that. Today's motion has been an opportunity to be upfront about the challenges facing the Scottish convenience sector. And I hope to see real actions taken following this debate to support the sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Guzzo. I now call on Minister Joe Fitzpatrick to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thanks to Gordon MacDonald for bringing this motion before Parliament and for members' contributions. highlighting the importance of the retail convenience store sector to Scotland. These debates are always enlightening, and I certainly wasn't aware that the Parliament had at least two daughters of grocers in Audrey Nicholl and Pam Gossel. So it's always useful to kind of hear more about the experiences, and I'm sure both Pam and Audrey will have many stories to tell. It is without doubt that our local retailers and convenience stores provide vital local access services and flexible employment opportunities. As Gordon MacDonald and others, I think, said, they contribute so much to their communities, often acting as the only local hub in towns and villages and neighbourhoods across Scotland. Willie Coffey highlighted how they've taken on many of the traditional roles we would have seen elsewhere on the high street as society has adapted to changing trends and the digital age, whether that be postal and banking services or energy and communication needs, besides the food and drink offer that they have. And it was useful to hear about the pilots and the Go Local offer. They're crucial to community resilience, building social interaction, fostering a positive sense of community and supporting active and vibrant local communities. And it was good to hear from several members talking about the contribution of grocers across Scotland during the pandemic. We all want, I think, our town and neighbourhood centres to be diverse, sustainable and thriving places for communities to live, work and enjoy. We want our towns and town centres to be vibrant, creative, enterprising and accessible, where people can meet most of their daily needs within a reasonable distance of their home, enabling them to live better, healthier lives and support our net zero ambitions. And I think Murdo Fraser made the point about how if we're going to get to net zero, then the convenience stores are the stores that are within walking distance to most of our population, walking or cycling or wheeling.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for the Minister to give way. And in the statistics that I presented to the House, 39% are located in isolated areas where they are literally the only available store for people. How does the Minister see supporting those and towards both the net zero but also their basic survival?
Minister.
So clearly, particularly if it's the only hub and it will be providing that range of services, then I think we all have a role in terms of supporting our local stores. And I'll come on to talk a little bit about some of the work that we are doing, but I think it's important to be clear that this is not, and it never is, a kind of party political sphere. It's an area that I work very closely with the COSLA spokesperson, Councillor Gail McGregor, who's a member of Mr Fraser's party, and we work very, very closely because I think we all realise the huge importance of this sector, not just to our economy, but much, much more to our local communities. So clearly, local convenience shops and retailers play that key role, ensuring people can live well locally, ensuring access to food and those plethora of other services that we've talked about. And members have also talked about the services that many of those stores provide for people who are have ability issues, disability issues, infirmity and lack of transport. So it's really, really important. As Mr MacDonald said, convenience stores are massively important to local jobs, in many cases offering a range of flexible hours, can also offer skills development and flexible and successful careers for a first job in a local store, to be the potential of distribution, supply chain businesses, large stores, ownership or management. Real opportunities for the local community. Going back to Mr Whitfield's point, they can only continue if we support them. So I think that is one of the really important things, which is why I think the Scotland Loves Local scheme is so important. And we really encourage people to consider that if they're spending money local, they're not only supporting that local shop, they're supporting their friends, their family, their neighbours. Really, really important. I'm mindful that I'm taking a bit of time, so I'm going to try and touch on one or two of the challenges which members have rightly raised. Murdo Fraser and Martin Whitfield both talked about non-domestic rates, and obviously there is a budget process which we have to go through, but it is important, I think, to remember in last year's budget the big ask of the Scottish Government was in terms of freezing the poundage, and Scotland did manage to freeze the poundage. So we have the lowest poundage in the UK for the fifth year in a row, a package of reliefs worth an estimated £749 million. I would contend that we provide the best support across these islands to retail business, particularly the smaller end of that spectrum, but recognise the challenges that are raised, and that is why the New Deal for Business group, which has established a consultative subgroup to advise on non-domestic rates, so that those discussions are being taken forward by the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, and clearly decisions have to be made in time for the budget. Several members raised the issue around crime, and Murdo Fraser in particular, and Pam Gosal, I think, talked about the challenges around organised crime. This is, without question, a really serious issue. It seems to be developing, and it's something that we need to work together. So the Scottish Government and its partners on the Serious Organised Crime Task Force are fully committed to tackling serious crime in all of its guises and reducing the harm it causes to our communities. Partners on that task force will use every means at their disposal to disrupt the activities of organised crime groups and hold them to account for the harm they cause to communities and businesses, particularly our most vulnerable. But I tend to agree with Martin Whitfield that there are other factors at play, and I think last month the First Minister cited Dr Sinead Fury, a senior lecturer in consumer management and food innovation at the University of Ulster, who is very clear that stealing to eat has taken place in previous times of economic downturn, and while there's no suggestion that it is the only driver, clearly there are concerns right now in terms of the impact of the cost of living crisis. Never an excuse, of course. And Mr Whitfield particularly mentioned violence against retail workers, which can never ever be acceptable. Obviously, the Parliament voted to bring in the Retail Workers Act, which came into force in August 2021. Statistics from that are just coming through, but in that quarter from August 2021 to August 2022, statistics just I think last week published showed that there were 27 individuals were prosecuted under that legislation, 26 of those were convicted, a conviction rate of 96%, and I think it's important that of those 50% of those received a custodial sentence, which I think shows the seriousness of the nature of the offences. It's an area that I, as the Minister with responsibility for retail, take really seriously, and the industry leadership group will be looking at this in terms of a deep dive as to what more we can do collectively to deal with the challenge. Presiding Officer, I see time is on us, so I am going to conclude by saying a huge thank you to our convenience sector across Scotland for the vital services they provide to our communities across the country. And I also want to extend my particular thanks to the Scottish Grocers Federation on promoting responsible community retailing amongst its membership. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.